You bring yourself and your energy.
Hi.
Now, what did you just say? Tell them exactly what you just told me.
Are you gonna have the baby, or the other half gonna have the baby?
No. Said the other
you
way.
You gonna have twins?
She said, "You gonna be a mommy or
daddy?"
My YouTube channel.
Hi, YouTube.
Say what's up. This is my auntie, y'all.
Hi.
She look like my grandma. Her hair is popping though. Y'all see her? She's looking good.
Thank you, Brandy.
We're having a family day.
She's having a girl?
She got five. Hi, YouTube.
Who having twins?
How you doing?
Yeah.
My sister's belly. She's sticking out pretty good.
Look at her eating. Jennifer said,
"It's only one baby in this stomach."
You ain't going to know until she's 28.
You don't know until it comes out. My auntie is a twin. She knows. She knows what it's like to share the womb in there.
Oh, yeah.
How did she check your stomach with the doctor appointment at the house?
She got a sonogram machine.
She's going to have it in the swimming pool.
She'll be there.
Y'all going to see a natural birth. That's natural birth.
We'll push it out in the bathtub, in the swimming pool.
In the birthing pool. Was instead of me waiting to go into labor, I got induced. And you know, when you get induced, your body is not naturally in. If I would have went in labor on my own, my body would have been able to do what it was supposed to do.
You can be retrained to like be back on track.
You have to let your body naturally do what it's supposed to do.
So what happens if you get into trouble?
Then we already have the hospital route planned out and all of that. So you have
her and another nursing person? Okay.
Yep, it'll be my midwife and it'll be two midwives.
I'll see what I gotta go through. Look at this. This is my auntie, y'all.
Hi.
This is my other auntie. Y'all done met my mama and seen her in the store. You done seen her. And you know about this one.
I'm back.
What's up, y'all? I'm filming today for no apparent reason. I just felt like talking to y'all. This morning, it's fall out here. It feels good. I'm not gonna lie. This breeze is nice. Fresh out the shower, feeling good. About to start this day. I'll take y'all with me this morning. I am not going anywhere spectacular or extravagant this morning. And I'm just about to go get some studying in. And I'm almost done reading this book. I will have read the whole entire textbook. You would think I'm like super scholastic and all of that, but I'm just, you know, on the cusp. So I'm about to read y'all this story because I can't get it out of my head. It's ridiculous. Ridiculous, man. The story is... I'm just about to read y'all the story. I've never heard of anything like this. In the textbook, they give us like... it'll be some little excerpts about plane accidents and stuff like that and things like that that happen to make us privy of and more clear of what to do and what not to do. It's titled Inside a Thunderstorm because we're talking about the weather. On July 27th, 1959, U.S. Marine Corps Lieutenant Colonel William H. Rankin was forced to eject from his jet at 40,000 feet. Generally, most people would be incapacitated by the low atmospheric pressure at the altitude. However, Lieutenant Rankin was not so lucky. He remained conscious as he descended into a well-developed severe thunderstorm. Let me just pause for a second. The man was ejected from his jet in the thunderstorm. Okay, let me go on. Although it should have taken him only 10 minutes to pass through the thunderstorm, the updrafts, the wind blowing up the thunderstorm, kept him inside the cloud for 40 minutes. He battled for survival in temperatures as low as negative 57 degrees Celsius. That's negative 71 degrees Fahrenheit. All the while being pelted with hailstorms, blinded by lightning, deafened by thunder, and soaked by driving rain. At one point, the rain was so torrential that Lieutenant Rankin thought he might survive everything else only to be drowned. To this day, he might be the only person to have ever survived such an ordeal. That is crazy. Crazy, bro. That shit is crazy. The thing that they're not talking about is the message from God in this. I'm like, it took me straight to the belly of Jonah in the whale's belly. That's exactly where this story took me. The only thing is we don't see what God's message is to this man, but can you imagine if he don't believe in nothing after surviving that, if you didn't believe in nothing after surviving that, man. Just 40 minutes inside a cloud, inside a thunderstorm, just drowning, falling. You've supposed to be and hit the ground by then. I mean, I guess suppose he must have been wearing a parachute, but 47,000 feet in the air. I just had to share that with y'all. I'm in here studying. I'll check back. I found something else that's interesting. A job of scientists put a plane specifically made for this and put themselves in a center of a hurricane. Instruments to calculate what's going on inside the storm. I know ain't no black people on this plane. Listen, that's not a job that I want. Guess who's done? Not me. Not done yet.
Sip their tea.
I was not talking to y'all again until I finished the book. The whole thing. Your girl is done. The real work begins now, you know. Honestly, it's taken me a couple months, you know. Y'all seen it. Y'all been here along the way watching. Let me get up out of this. Oh my goodness. I'm so excited. Like, y'all have no idea. I can just study. You know, I can study and I can find out exactly. My eyebrows is looking a mess. What I need to actually prepare for the stuff that I gotta actually do. I probably could stand to read the whole book again. I'm not gonna read it all the way straight through again. In today's journey of reading, I did read some really interesting stuff, and I know I shared some of that with y'all already, but it's more ridiculous. This scared me. I'm not even gonna lie, like, this scared me. Y'all tell me, am I out of my mind for still pursuing this career? I don't know what is going on with my eyebrows. Y'all tell me if I'm out of my mind for still pursuing this career after I tell y'all this. Okay, so what I'm reading about today, I heard about this, but I really read about it today. There's something called a wind shear, burst of air that comes out of nowhere. It can happen at any altitude to any pilot at any level, and it can happen anywhere. Like a micro burst of air and push you down or to the side. So you're flying along and then all of a sudden, whoosh, like a burst of wind just comes, smashes the plane down. And if you're already close to the ground, depends on how powerful that is, it can smash you right into the ground. Basically, it was like three planes flying into this airport, right? These are jets, like not little baby planes like what I'm flying. These two jets already land and it's a thunderstorm nearby. They're talking to in the tower on the ground. They're approving all of these flights to land. The small rain shower had grown considerably in only 12 minutes. This is 12 minutes after the other two people landed. Captain, who had nearly 30,000 flight hours, that's an actual number, guys, 30,000 flight hours, recognized the classic signs of the wind shear and to issue warnings and instructions to his the officer pilot next to him. So the jet was buffeted to a downdraft that caused the airplane to lose 44 knots, that's a lot of speed, of indicated airspeed in 10 seconds. With intense gusts, turned the airplane nearly sideways and caused the airspeed to drop 140 knots. In the next 13 seconds, it was hit with six changes in the wind direction and caused the load factor to go from negative 0.3 to 2.3s. That means because the wind is pushing the plane around so much from this wind shear that's happening, and the wind changed direction six times in this 10 seconds, the plane has now increased its weight from the structural, you know, it's got to maintain its structure from all this pushing around. So now the plane has become twice as heavy as it actually is. And he's going to try it again. Like, okay, I was going to land, but nah, something's going on. Let me try it again. So it says, but it was too late. The huge jet was already out of control, bounced once, then came back to Earth on a highway and skidded to a stop near the northern edge of the airport. The crash killed 134 people on the 165 people on board the airplane and one person on the ground. Transportation board kind of blamed it on the pilots. I mean, you know, you have to be aware of, and to me, it seems like a lot of flight training is preparing for shit to happen, to go bad, and know what to do when it does. And this pilot had 30 1,000 hours. Oh my God. He saw it coming, but he didn't fix it in enough time, and the storm wasn't letting up. It's still on my mind. It just had me thinking, like, all right, y'all tell me, would you still be pursuing this career after reading these traumatizing stories that I have been reading today? I'm out of here. I'm done. I am so, so, so grateful to be done reading this book. What do you guys think? Comment down below. Let me know. Make sure you like. Make sure you subscribe. Make sure you turn on your post bell notifications. Peace out, y'all.